Good evening. Pleasure to see all of you here. And I'll probably use more than just a couple minutes because I suspect my party may be the least familiar to you of the five up here. The Christian Heritage Party, we have run in the formerly McLeod, now Foothills Riding in the past. But many of you may not be familiar with us, and you may wonder when you see the name of our party, Christian Heritage. This is just a party for Christians. Not all Canadians are Christians, what's this about? And it's a fair question, but I would direct you to the name of the party and remind you that it's Christian Heritage Party. Both of those words are important. We certainly recognize that Canada is not a solely Christian nation. It never has been. And yet it's an indisputable fact that the foundations on which Canada was built, the glorious and free country that we have today, was built by adherence to principles out of a Judeo-Christian ethic. And the principles that I know are especially strong in the West and in this particular riding, values of self-sacrifice, self-reliance, and that means, in many cases, limited government. I would really love to see Allison come down and use her expertise to start one of those wells she was talking about. But I don't think it's the place of a government in Ottawa to be deciding what priorities in every riding across the country are the most important to pursue. The federal government has a role. It's important, but it's a very limited role. And that role is to set up the situation, create the rules for each individual in Canada, each company in Canada, each area in Canada, to meet its needs. There's not a bureaucrat in Ottawa who can keep track. The people here, FCSS, organizations in towns, they know the needs. They know where money can most efficiently and effectively be used. Ottawa can't do that. And the Conservative Party has been in control of this part of the country for some time. And I think many of you perhaps have voted Conservative in the past, expecting a Conservative government, and unfortunately haven't gotten it. The size of the federal government has grown every single year since the Harper Conservatives took office. It's grown a total of 42% since their beginning. And that restraint, that's what you want to call it, is not what we need. The problem is that self-reliance, those values that built our country, have been left behind to a large extent. And it's Thomas Jefferson who said, I know he's not Canadian, but he has some wisdom on this topic, democracy will last until the people discover that they can vote themselves a share of the public purse. And I think that realization is starting to trickle out. That's why parties are promising millions for this and billions for that, trying to buy you. But remember, the government has no money. All the money the government has is yours. They don't know the priorities. They need to set up a system so that you know those priorities. And what's fundamental is that along with rights come responsibilities. And the exercise of those responsibilities is what the federal government should be allowing their citizens to do. I'm convinced that every human life has value. Every individual has value. This year, 2015, is the 800th anniversary of the signing of Magna Carta. Many of you will be familiar with that. It's fundamental to the freedoms we take for granted in the West. And the basis of Magna Carta was that no one is above the law. The king is also subject to the law, the same law as all of the citizens. So that value of every human life is fundamental to our nation. It's fundamental to our party. It's why I'm running. Because, unfortunately, I am the only candidate in this riding who really believes in the value of every human life. It's very strange that I'm the only such candidate. The UN Declaration on the Rights of the Child, to which Canada is a signatory, states that the child needs special safeguards and care, including appropriate legal protection before as well as after birth. Canada signed that, it's never upheld that. You may know of the Morgenthaler decision of 1988, when Canada's abortion laws were struck down. The narrative that has taken hold in this country is that abortion has been declared legal. In fact, that's not the case. If you look at the actual decision from the Supreme Court, they stated that human life, the protection of the fetus is a pressing and substantial concern that would justify limits on abortion. It's the Morgenthaler decision. they referred to the legislature to determine what the appropriate limits would be. The legislature has tried, but they've given up. They haven't touched it. Every other country in the Western world restricts abortion. The social justice havens of Scandinavia, every country in Europe, Russia, Africa. There's three countries in the entire world with no legal restrictions on the taking the life of the unborn. Those three are North Korea, China, and Canada. Not very auspicious international company. In Canada, right up to the moment of birth, abortion is fully legal. You'll say, well, it doesn't happen. It does. It does. The best estimates, the government hides the statistics on this, but the best estimates we can find is that of the 100,000 abortions per year, that's 4,000 empty classrooms in this country every single year. Of those, nearly 900 are post-viability. Picture this. In a hospital, in one wing, is a doctor frantically trying with the best modern medical technology to save the life of a premature child. A few doors down is another doctor taking the life of a child who's more developed than that. That's the situation in Canada. It's fully legal. 2 minutes of time, 2 inches of distance, give you a license to kill. It's unconscionable. And I know it's a controversial issue. I don't like standing up here as a target, but this is the single biggest human rights issue that we face as a country. It's uncomfortable. You may be feeling uncomfortable now because you can't reconcile it with your values. The reason you are here and feeling uncomfortable is because you were born. Every one of us is just a grown-up embryo. Without life, no other questions. No questions of economy, no questions of freedom, no other issues matter. You need to know about this. Now, the CHP is not a single issue party. Sometimes we're characterized that way. We have a full platform. I hope to tell you about a lot of it tonight. The problem is that the life of the unborn is a single party issue. Every other party muzzles their members on this. The Liberals, strong pro-life MPs who've been an effective voice for their constituents for many years, like Lawrence McCauley. In order to run for the Liberal Party this time, he had to deny his conscience. Candidates like Reverend Shanti Kumar, a Christian Tamil pastor in Toronto, Scarborough, is an NDP candidate. In order to be allowed to run, he had to promise he would violate his conscience if it came up in the House. Elizabeth May is a signatory of a declaration calling for Canada to adopt a two-child policy, similar to that in China, where genocide of unborn children is common and acknowledged. In the Conservative Party, where many pro-lifers expect to find a home, there are strong pro-life MPs, but they're muzzled. Warawa, now take down the list. Non-pro-life people will typically tell you they're not pro-abortion, and I know there are a range of views on what limits are appropriate. If you believe in human rights, you must agree that some limits are appropriate. Most Canadians do. Vast majority, over 80%, every time it's been asked since the 80s, more than 80% of Canadians agree that third trimester abortions ought not to be legal. Despite this, we know what happens, and no party is willing to touch it. There's abortion for contraception. There's gender-selective abortion. There's abortion because of disability. There's women who are killed specifically to kill their unborn child, and it doesn't count as a life. I challenge every one of my colleagues up here to explain on what basis they deny rights to the most vulnerable Canadians. And if they say something about the mother's choice, they're dodging the question. The whole point here is that there are two people involved. Really, the only question in this debate is the unborn human? You will hear tonight about evidence-based policy. This is the most evidence-based policy you will ever see. 100% of embryology texts, 100% of doctors will tell you a human life begins at conception. And the fact that parties are silencing their members on this fundamental issue should worry every one of you, wherever you stand on this. Because if they won't protect their own MPs' conscience rights, their MPs who should be speaking for the voters, not for the party, they should be representing their constituents, if they won't allow their members to speak, why would they protect conscience rights of other Canadians? Euthanasia, we require a law, according to the Supreme Court, within this next year. There's a slippery slope involved there. We know it from every country where it's been introduced. How long until doctors are required, against their conscience, to participate in physician-assisted suicide, despite their Hippocratic oath and their duty of care? How long until pastors who believe marriage is between one man and one woman are required to officiate at weddings they cannot in good conscience agree with? Why would you trust parties to protect you when they won't protect their own members? Why would you trust other parties to act morally based on firm principles, unchanging principles, not based on what Tuesday's poll said a chunk of the electorate would like? You maybe are thinking, what about separation of church and state? Well, good, I'm glad. I also fully support that. The problem is that in seeking the separation of church and state, what we have ended up with in this country is a separation of morals from government. We came into the conservative government with a sponsorship scandal. We're maybe leaving it, certainly dealing right now with a Senate scandal. Individual principles matter. And everything government does, in fact, comes down to a moral principle. Debt.
Can we get back to politics?
Getting right there, ma'am. We spend today...
I'm not here for church.
We spend today money. We don't pay off our debt from the 70s and 80s. We're still paying the interest on that. That's at the expense of tomorrow. Generations to come, when interest goes up, it's going to. They're going to have to pay that back. That's stealing from future generations. Debt is a moral issue. Even now, it's waste. Tens of millions of dollars every day are just going to pay off the interest on the debt. I can think of a lot better ways to spend $10 million than flushing it down the toilet. We would pay down the debt like a mortgage. The reason we got into debt in the first place is because we're renting money from commercial banks. And that's a role that we as small parties can play. We can develop innovative policy solutions. A number of them have been taken over. We're glad to see that. But the Bank of Canada has the ability to issue money and to municipalities, to provincial governments, at zero interest, to retire that money from circulation when it is repaid, avoids inflation. After World War II, this was done very successfully by the Liberal government of King and kicked off the longest-lasting boom in the Canadian economy. There's ideas that are proven that work. We defend the rights of children, debt in the future, but also families now. Families are the best place for children to be raised. Children need their mother and their father. They shouldn't be pushed into daycare. Of course, that option needs to be there for those who need it. But most Canadians, when they're asked, say they would like to take care of their children at home. The economy doesn't allow it. We would make that possible. We have a commitment to a $1,000 a month family care allowance where one adult stays home to care for their own children or for a elderly or disabled parent or family member. That care, much cheaper than hospitals, much more beneficial to communities, builds those connections, allow us to gain from the wisdom of seniors, of whom there are more. For the first time this week, last week was announced, more seniors than youth in Canada. It's a problem that's going to get bigger. We need innovative solutions to meet the challenges of the future. We can find them based on the principles that make Canada great. Those principles lead us to policies. We have better solutions for Canada's problems, and I look forward to telling you about more of them this evening. Thank you.